All right, so previously we saw that we really cared about this expression, this du, d epsilon expression, and we said that ds, d epsilon, so for our strain, for basically metals, polymers, ceramics, polymers specifically that are below the Tg, that the change in entropy as we strain our system is negligible. So really, it's the change in the internal energy of our system which leads to all of kind of the unique things of elasticity for our system. But for materials, especially polymers, where our temperature is greater than Tg, the glass transition temperature, that behavior is actually going to be dominated by the entropic response. Specifically, we're going to see a type of entropic spring-like restoration force that leads to elastic behavior. So hopefully you've seen, heard about polymers before, and that there's a characteristic relaxation time when you basically load a polymer. Most polymers are viscoelastic. We'll get into that quite a bit of detail later. So basically it has a viscous or liquid-like response, and an elastic or a solid type response. So most of those are viscoelastic. There's also polymers that are elastomers, and basically they can exhibit elastic behavior for very long time scales. And this kind of concept of rubber elasticity is very general, and we are going to look at this kind of rubber elastic response, so for these polymer materials. So what is rubber elasticity? What is a rubber elastic? So when we talk about rubbers, we're really talking about elastomers, and we're talking about networks. And specifically cross-links. So cross-links can be chemical, most often they are. They can be physical, as long as our molecular weight is large enough. And basically these cross-links are, physical cross-links are like entanglements. So basically these cross-links are points. They could be either chemical or physical, but actually they could be bonded as well. But these crosslinks are basically fixed at these points. So the chains can't slide past one another at this point. They're very flexible and they could wiggle around in between the crosslinks. So they're very flexible there. But at those crosslink positions, they can't slip past one another. So if you're imagining, you're eating a delicious, I'm hungry right now, ramen or like a bowl of spaghetti, right? You can grab a single chain and then pull it out. And you could slide it past. They're flexible, they could slide past one another, those chains. But if you're able to kind of link them chemically or create a network, you couldn't pull out essentially one chain. Basically, when you have this kind of these cross links, the entire rubber is connected, and basically no individual chain can just diffuse randomly or move independently in response to any perturbation. So if I pull in a network, So if I pull on this network or apply a stress, this is going to move, in certain directions, it's going to infect the motion of the other material. So it is connected. It is going to have an overall, basically, there is going to be some part that is going to be an elastic response and one part that's going to be a viscous response. It's really, really critical to kind of, again, keep in mind that the rubber is composed, as we kind of said over and over, very, very flexible chains in between the crosslinks that can rearrange. So the presence of the crossing prevents the overall change from just flowing because you have those, again, permanent physical or chemical crosslinks. So we're going to have two relaxation times of a rubber. One that's going to be that solid, one that is much shorter with that liquid behavior. The liquid is, again, associated with polymers between the crosslinks. Longer relaxation time, the solid response is, again, associated with eventually removing those crosslinks. There are key assumptions before we get into kind of this derivation that we're going to go through. One, Gaussian subchains between permanent crosslinks. Basically, polymers free to kind of move around in there. Temperatures above Tg, yes, because if we didn't, we could just go back to our usual definition of basically Z over R naught, D squared U, D R squared. That would be how we would define our Young's modulus if we're below Tg. So temperature has to be above Tg. Flexible chains, again, that's kind of related into here. Chain deformation occurs by conformational changes. Basically, again, you're going to unwrap this polymer. No slip, no chain slip, they're permanent. This is a very, very critical statement. Affine deformation. Basically, the microscopic deformation is going to be the same as the macroscopic deformation. We're also going to assume that we are going to conserve no change in volume upon rubber. This is very, very, very important. Incompressibility assumption here. Very, very, very important. And then no crystallization of the change at large strains. So basically, we can't form a lamella structure, you know, as we pull and recrystallize. That happens a lot. Again, a lot of times these are, you know, in real systems, these will be, you know, basically broken. But again, we're looking at the ideal response. So this rubber elasticity framework that we're going to talk about, it will describe mechanical deformation. It will also describe gel swelling, too. So when you mix a solvent with a polymer and the volume increases. And like we've kind of hinted about previously, again, all of this energy, or, you know, as you stretch that polymer chains, you are going to decrease the conformational entropy of your system. So you're going to change the number of microstates. So you can see here, this final expression, that the energy for stretching, you see here, as temperature increases, that energy increases. Again, that's not good. We want energy to decrease. But you can see here, actually, it'll change the number of microstates. This R is our end-to-end distance of our polymer chains. We're going to get into that in a second. But as you increase the size of that system, you reduce the number of microstates. You increase the energy of your system here. So that will be combated when we come back to it. So there's going to have to be some force that fights back against that. Same thing when you compress the system as well. But again, that's for another time. So next time, we are going to get into rubber elasticity derivations. We're going to look at basically uniaxial deformation to kind of, and then look at some of the limits. So we'll probably break those apart in a couple of videos. But that's just our kind of first step, understanding what is a network, what is a rubber elasticity, what are kind of the key assumptions. Again, no change in volume. We're going to have affine deformation. And then those are going to be kind of the key aspects. And all right, we'll see you next time. Thanks. Bye.